I think what I'm asked to do is to say a few words by way of an introduction to the panel and the continuation of the discussion. So that's what I'm going to try and do. I don't know whether it's going to be provocative or not, but the first thing I wrote down when I tried to pen a few notes for myself for this session was, we have failed. And I think we have to recognize that, because as simply as just making a comparison with the public and private sectors and the community and voluntary sector, let's take the private sector first. If you're lucky enough not to have lost your job, the probability is that your income is more or less the same as it was at the onset of the crisis. That's not obviously universally true, but the statistics would tend to suggest that incomes have held up. Obviously, everyone in the private sector has had to bear the charges and the universal social charge and all the other things that have been applied across the economy. In the public sector, by and large, there's been no compulsory redundancies, but people have taken an average reduction in income of about 15%. In the community and voluntary sector, I think it's fair to say that we have had not just incomes, but we've jobs slashed as well. So it's another way of describing, I think, what Brian and Anne presented very compellingly earlier on. And that's because clearly the community and voluntary sector was seen as a soft target. I think it's also because, if the truth be told, we have failed to adopt a defensive strategy on behalf of the community and voluntary sector in what is a savage recession. We've been unable, for whatever reason, and I think we have to kind of put these things out there, to capture the scale of the cuts in a way that commands sufficient public and political support. We failed to make government account for the effect that the cuts on services and communities are having. And we've failed to make government, and particularly the senior elements of the civil service, engage with us on alternatives to secure cost reductions that would maintain and preserve community services. I think it's fair to say that street protest has been seen as the main strategy. I think it's fair to say that we've failed to galvanize workers, at least galvanize sufficient numbers of workers into unions around winnable demands. Winnable demands that, if we win them, would build confidence. And I think, you know, sometimes people, maybe people like myself, who try to tell it as it is, are then dismissed. In the end of the day, the purpose here is to see what we can unite around. There isn't much point, it seems to me, in having a political debate when we all know we may have varying political views. We need to come up with things we can unite around. Add to that the fact that within the community and voluntary sector, there is an amount of rivalry between organizations. Let's face it, that's just a fact of life. Add to it the difficulty sometimes in defining where the community and voluntary sector begins and ends and the boundaries between organizations, and it is a tough job to try and come up with a successful strategy. So troubling, worrying, difficult and all as that is, I think that is where we have to start from. And we have to start there because our opponents have a strategy. And when Brian and Anne set it out, this is very much a strategy to set aside all the gains that were achieved in the community sector in particular over the last few decades. And it's not something that's particularly unique to Ireland, but my own view is it is a conscious decision, and it's one, it's a political decision that's based in the belief that either these people, either they don't vote or they vote for other people other than the people who are in power. I think we can see some of that in the Department of Public Expenditure and Reform document from 2011, the cross-cutting document that we got our hands on some time ago, where you can see there's a new look being taken in the context of the Commission on Public Expenditure, looking at how the spend happens right across the community and voluntary sector. I think we've got to focus on those issues that we can unite around, including within the unions, those things that we can identify as achievable goals that we can build support for. In the short term, I think that we need to get better at political lobbying in localities and in constituencies. And with one eye on the local elections that are coming up, I think it's an opportunity to try and put pressure on the political system around the cuts that have taken place and the cuts that are continuing. I think we need to look at what opportunities can there be for fresh links with new and emerging funding streams. We've already heard a bit about what's happening within the HSE, the move to the Children and Families Agency, and a whole load of the developments in relation to the local authorities. So there are new arrangements emerging, and I think that's an opportunity, if we grab it, where we could try and have some more influence. I think, essentially, we've got to get a force, an engagement with government about the community and voluntary sector in a way where they take us seriously, because if we don't do that, we're really at nothing. It's about 18 months ago that since some of us in this room attended a meeting that took place in the Department of Public Expenditure and Reform, at which a number of government departments were represented by senior officials. And it was evident, certainly evident to me, that there was no seriousness in that room. Their job was to cut expenditure. They had made a calculation that they could cut deeper in the community and voluntary sector. Not only that, they didn't even have to face the consequences because they could outsource that to all of the community organizations. And that's the fact of the matter in terms of what's been happening. I think we have to, as trade unions, recognize that collective bargaining also can mean within organizations issues for the individual workers, whether they're redundancies or issues related to pay and conditions generally. They're the reasons why people join unions, and they're it's assistance with those issues that people expect to get when they're in unions. I think, you know, and I've felt this for a while, that I think we probably have to separate out, in order to be effective, different services. So as well as coming together in the round like we are today, I think we need to look at discrete areas, whether it's children's services or childcare or youth services or whatever the case may be, and to try and build unity among workers in those particular areas so that we can then use that to put pressure on that particular aspect of government. And just going back to the point that was made in relation to privatization, it is absolutely the case that there is a drive towards privatization, not just in Ireland, but across Europe at the moment, where public services, or services that are in the to the benefit of the citizenry, are being driven out for commercial profit, sometimes via the community sector on the way to that commercial entity. And that's happening because the powers that be really don't care too much about who delivers the service. What they want to be able, and they'll sell it to the public on this basis, they want to be able to say the service will be more accessible, it'll be more responsive, it'll be more flexible, and it'll be more personal. But we know, in the end of the day, if the service survives at all, it'll be about profit and very little else. And we have an opportunity, because I don't believe the public at large really buy that argument. I think that there is good respect for public services and for community services. Indeed, at the weekend, it was shown in one of the OECD reports that Ireland has a very high level of support for public services. So there's an opportunity, you know, if we get our messaging right, to engage not just with the wider public, but let's face it, with the wider trade union membership as well, to build support for that. So there are just some thoughts, David, you know, personal thoughts really about what we need to focus on. I don't think there's any point in pretending that we haven't been outmaneuvered, because we clearly have. It's about trying to see what can we unite on and where can we...